Hello, everybody. Welcome back. Today, we are looking at some merchant interaction. If you follow us from the previous video, we built this UI before. I added a small close button here, but other than that, it's the same UI that we had before. The main thing now is that we added also a model for the merchant and a way to interact with the merchant to trigger the UI and start the interaction with the merchant. So we're going to look into that today. First, let's just take a look at the finished product. We'll take a look inside the headset and see how it's working, and then I'll walk you through everything that I did. Okay, so the scene starting. As usual with SteamVR, for whatever reason, the hands don't appear until I reset the scene. So with the scene reloaded, now here I have the merchant set here for a cycle animation. There's still some work to do to actually trigger the animation when you interact so that the merchant stands and then sits back down without the interaction, you can see now. But for now, the merchant is just going on a loop of sitting around, and when the sitting animation ends, transitions to standing, then transitions to an idle. Now that I'm in range of the merchant, I can interact with the merchant, and this triggers the UI here. It works pretty much the same way before. You can select what items you want to sell, then sell it. It actually executes the transaction. The one thing that I added was a close button so we can stop the interaction, and that close button would also trigger this animation of sitting back down. Whenever I would interact with the merchant, that would trigger the animation for the merchant to stand up as a secondary, and then stay in the saddle animation. But I haven't set up those animation triggers yet. For now, it's just cycling with animation, which is okay. So that's basically it. That's what I have today. Let's see how that's actually possible. So let's go through all the changes first. There was a little bit of a change that I added here, unrelated, but it's cool to go through. I added an input config scriptable object that you can see here. It's pretty straightforward. I'm using the OVR input class that comes with the Oculus SDK. I'm just using two variables here that are private. One is the button enum, and the other is the controller enum. This basically lets us set which button we're going to be looking for, and this is which controller, because the way that the button here is set up, you could actually look at the same button, the button 1 or button 2, in both controllers at the same time. And that's something you could set up, or you could set only for the left controller, only for the right controller, or whatever combination. You also get access to other controllers like the hands controllers that the Quest tracks, although you don't have any buttons in the hands, but you could actually use them as tracking in some way. So this supports these two filters, and then implements the OVR method in them. So you have a get down, basically get button down, and then checks for this button in this controller. Did we click it? Or did we press it down? Similar for get up and get. For now, I'm just using get down, but we could use get up and get as needed. Get is the continuous version of get down. So if you're holding the button, you want to use get. So that's set up here, and you can see here for a few things I have this game state script is the one that I use for reloading the scene. So you can see here in the reload input, I'm using button 2 on the L touch controllers as the Y in the left controller. And I'm also using here in the interactor component of the player, which is what's gonna trigger the interactions with the merchant and with any other interactables that we have. But here it has, we'll look into this, but it has a radius and also has an interact input here that I'm using, and that's the index trigger in the right touch controller. Technically, this could and probably should be both. So any controller that has the trigger pulled should trigger the interaction, so you should be able to interact with things with both hands. But yeah, that's what we have here for the interactable. So past the input config, we have two main things. One is the interactable component, and the other is the interactor component. The interactable, as you can see here, is pretty straightforward. It has a unity event that will encode in this the behavior that we want to have when the interactable is interacted upon, and then it has simply a public method to trigger that uninteract event that we're going here interact. And the fun comes in interactor component. As you can see, it's a little bit larger. I have a few things here. We have a float reference, basically a float that sets the interact radius. So we can say how long is the range. I, for example, tested it at a 1 distance, basically a 1 meter distance. And it was too short. You had to get really close to the merchant to be able to interact with him. But I set that as a 2 now, and that seems a little bit more intuitive to be able to interact at that 2-meter distance. Just if you think about it, VR space socially, 2 meters would be the close social distance there. Anything else gets a little bit too close and just doesn't feel quite right. Then we have an input here that we're using is like what is actually going to trigger the interaction. Here's what we saw before is the trigger on either controller, as we said it now. And then we have a few instance variables here. We have the colliders in range. It's basically going to help us see which colliders are inside the interact radius. And then we have interactables in range. This is where we actually select from everything that we found in this interaction radius, what is actually interactable. And then we also keep track of the closest interactable, because we cannot interact with everything at the same time, or at least we don't want to interact with everything at the same time. We keep track of which of the interactables is the closest, and then we only work on that. So let's see this. We set up the interactables in range, initialize that. Then every fixed update cycle, we are checking for the input. And if the input is there, we simply interact. Then when we are calling this interact, we just check if the closest interactable is actually set up, then we interact with the closest interact. That's what we saw here, right? It's just triggering this unity event on the interactable. And then it's the really interesting stuff, which is how do we select the closest interactable? So first of all, we have a trigger here. If you look in the interactor here, we have a collider that's a trigger. We're using this to make sure that we call the onTriggerEnter and onTriggerExit functions. And when you're dealing with trigger interactions, you need to have a rigid body on either end. So if we want to collide with the merchant here, either the merchant has a rigid body or you should have a rigid body. In this case, I went with having the interactor component having a rigid body that's kinematic. It's only there to trigger the collisions there, so that the merchant himself doesn't really need a rigid body. It's going to be static for the most part. And if we see into the actual model at the spine, we have the actual collider that is going to trigger everything. And you can see based on the animation, the spine pretty much stays upright the whole time. So that's a nice place to set this capsule collider. If we wanted to be more specific, we could have a specific collider for every body part and then they would move accordingly. But that's overkill for what we need here. But we have that collider available. So when we have the onTriggerEnter or TriggerExit callbacks, we update the interactables, onTriggerEnter and onTriggerExit. When we have the update interactables call, this is where we do this part. We call physics overlap sphere and we give it the current position. This is the collider position or just the game object position. And then the radius that we want to check. So this is the interact radius that we said before. And that gives us an array of colliders. Now, Ryder here says that we should use overlap sphere non-alloc instead of overlap sphere. I tried that a little bit before and for whatever reason, it wasn't capturing the colliders in the array here. It may be something that I'm missing here, but for now, I'm going with this since this is actually working. Then, once we have all the colliders in range, we clear out the list of interactables here. And as long as there's a collider in the colliders in range, we execute this loop where we're going through every collider and trying to get the interactable component. And here, I'm using getComponent in parent because if you remember, the collider itself is sitting in the spine object of the model, which is not where we want to have the interactable component. The interactable component is at the root. So this way, if we have some complex collider interactions, we just know that at some point, one of the parents of the colliders must have an interactable. And that's the pattern that we're going with here. You could choose to do it differently. And if we have an interactable, then we add that interactable to the list. And once we have all the interactables, we also call the getClosestInteractable to update the closestInteractable as well. And this closest interactable is pretty straightforward, but it has a few things here to keep in mind. First, if we don't have any interactables in range, we keep it as null. Then we are keeping track of the indices of the list. This is just not to generate more allocation and garbage, because we could create another variable, but just pre-optimization here using the index instead. And then we set up the closest distance to infinity so that we start at the edge of the spectrum here. Like anything that's closer than infinity would be the closest in the beginning. And then we go through every interactable that is in range, and we check with the vector3.distance the distance between the transform position of the interactable, this would be the center of the collider or the interactable, against our current position. So it gives us a distance between where we are and where the collider in range is, or the center of that collider is. And then if that distance is less than the current closest distance, start at infinity, then we store that distance at the closest distance, and then we store that index as the closest interactable index. And we go through the loop, and with this, whichever interactable is closest will be stored in the closest distance, and we'll keep that in. So we just return that at the end, and that gives us the closest interactable. And that's pretty much it for the interactables and the interactors and interactables. There's at least one more thing that changed here. I added a method here to make sure that the UI starts hidden. That should be it. Those are all the changes for now. As you saw before, that gives us this nice UI where you can get close to the merchant as long as you are in this range of the merchant, which this is the 2 meter radius here that we have. As long as you're within that range and you use the input here, that is the primary trigger on either touch controller, then we'll call the interact method in the merchant's interactable component. So here we see that we're in the interactable component here. We're setting the UI to active, so we actually show it. And then we're doing a little bit of a debug text here, so we show that we interact with the merchant. Obviously, that will go away later on. And then in the cell UI as well, we have this new close button here. Whenever we click on the close button, we set the cell UI to active false so that it actually closes. And that's pretty much it. That's what we have for today. Pretty straightforward. It took a little bit of fiddling with the animation. We will check the animation actually later on. For now, I'll just show you a preview. Here is a very straightforward loop. There's nothing exciting going on here. We just have a sitting animation, a stand-up animation, an idle animation, and then a kneel-down animation that we're using for the sitting back down. And then it goes back to sitting. For now, all of these transitions have no conditions. It's just going in a loop. As soon as one animation ends, the other starts. And that's pretty much it. Next time around, we'll figure out the conditions here for the animations so we can actually have the merchant stand up when we interact with him and have him sit down back again when we stop the interaction, which I think will be a nice touch for now. But that's it for today. Thank you for sticking around with me. I hope this was clear. I'll see you in the next one.